Well, hello there. So, today I'm going to talk about this beige box right here with the missing optical drive. So,
it used to be a Dell Dimension XPS T700R.
But now it is my new computer, my new desktop computer. I've been waiting to have a desktop computer, a proper desktop computer, for over a month now, since my other desktop died. My X70W and Plus motherboard, which is right here, died. Well, I killed it, technically. Since that board died, I've been waiting to have a proper desktop, and now I have it. So let's take a look at the outside. So on the front, we've got a whole lot of nothing right here. 1.44 megabyte floppy drive, which is connected and working. Power button, hard drive LED, this is the power LED, and reset switch, vents right here and here, and a little vent at the bottom. These are intakes. From this side, nothing but this little circle. On the other side, same thing, circle and some marks that I haven't gotten read off yet. On the bottom, we've got this kind of huge foot, like a snail. On the back, we've got the back of the Seasonic power supply right here. So power input, power switch, main power switch, exhaust fan. This is a 92 millimeter exhaust fan. Right now it is not speed controlled. It is hooked up straight to 12 volts on the motherboard, but I will be buying a PWM fan for this. We've got PS2 keyboard, PS2 mouse, 4 USB 2.0 ports, serial, integrated VGA, which is disabled, dual gigabit LAN. Here on other versions of this motherboard, there would be a 7.1 audio header, but there isn't here. We've got two dual link DVI-I ports, HDMI 1.2, I think, DisplayPort, two USB 3.0s, S-Video input, composite input, audio output from the tuner, and analog RF input and FM input. This is a capture card right here. So that's the outside of the computer. We've got a thumb screw right here to remove the side panel. And we've got two catches, one up here and one down here. And this requires a little bit of force to remove. So let me put the phone down a little bit. There we go. There's the side panel off. And let's take a look at the guts of the machine. So, first of all, storage. We've got right on the top, right here on the top, 5 1/4 inch bay, a 40 gigabyte Samsung spin point drive, just a drive that I had laying around. This is where my Windows install is. And my main storage, well, my main drive, which is an OCZ ARC 100 SSD. This is where my Linux Mint install is. I will be moving to Debian. I will be removing Mint from here, and I will be installing Debian. Well, that's storage. This is a 120 gigabyte SSD. Power supply, we've got a Seasonic M12-2 520 80 plus bronze power supply, semi-modular, right there. Right here, as you can see. Motherboard, we've got a Supermicro X7DCA-L X7DCA-L YL001 processors, we've got dual CPUs right here. These are dual Xeon X5450s running at 3 gigahertz. They are quad cores with 12 megabytes of L2 cache each. So 24 megabytes of L2 cache in total. And yeah. And 8 cores in total at 3 gigahertz. The coolers are Nox Hummers, I think. Nox Hummers. Yeah, Nox Hummers. They're just Chinese generic coolers rebranded as Nox. And I have installed them with little adapter brackets that I made so I could put AMD mounts, well, heat sinks that use AMD mounts on socket 771 mounts. As you can see, that bracket down there, I made 4 of those, and I just mounted these heat sinks right there. Graphics card. For the graphics card, we've got an XFX Radeon, well, ATI Radeon 5870, 1 gigabyte of GDDR5. It runs most games, well, it runs all the games out there right now, most PC games. No problems whatsoever. It pretty much maxes out just about everything at 1080p. Just the latest games, you have to crank the settings down a little bit. Down here we've got a USB 3.0 card, PCI Express 1X. And the PCI card, this is a Pinnacle Systems MTV something. Well, it is a capture card. It is, well, just a capture card. And my RAM has just arrived. So let's install it and see if this thing works. All right. So, the RAM is installed. We have mouse and keyboard connected. Display is connected. And we have power. So let's turn the thing on. Here goes nothing. Well, I'll have to turn it on. There goes that. Whoops. What's that? No memory error. Huh. Weird. That's a no memory error. I'll try resetting the CMOS.
Let's see, yeah, you have to do this. Jump to make contact in between those two jumpers. Right there with a screwdriver. Okay. There we go, CMOS is reset. Let's try that again. Same error. Huh.
Weird. I'll troubleshoot this. Welp, it's nighttime now. And my Dual Xeon plan has gone poof completely. This motherboard is dead. It will not detect the memory. It will not. The motherboard is dead. Absolutely dead. But I did manage to get another board that will work with the Xeons. Well, with one Xeon, only one. It isn't a server motherboard, it is a desktop motherboard. It is a Socket 775 motherboard. I got it from a friend. I actually got it in exchange for an Adel Optiplex 380 with and a Core 2 Duo, some old Core 2 Duo I had laying around, and he gave me this motherboard. Let me show you. He gave me this, which is proven. To work with Xeons when modified properly. This is an ASUS P5Q motherboard. Now, I don't have DDR2 memory, so I will have to buy DDR2 memory for it, but it seems like the price of DDR2 memory has plummeted in the last year, so that's all well and good. So yeah, and I can put all of my expansion cards, no problem. This PCI Express is 2.0, so great, no bottleneck right there if I ever wanna upgrade my GPU. I can put my USB 3.0 card in there, no problem either, and my capture card can go in whichever of these I want it to. It has a ton of SATA ports, I mean like 8 SATA ports. Why would you need 8 SATA ports? I'm only gonna use 2, but hey. It's got a floppy connector, which is good. And it's got an IDE connector, which is freaking awesome, because I will be able to use a beige optical drive on this computer for being more authentic. So that's another awesome point, and another awesome thing is that it has an 8-pin power connector right here, As you can see, I just removed the little, yeah, 8 pin, and it has an 8 phase power delivery system with cooling on the MOSFETs, on the switching MOSFETs. So that's pretty awesome. Oh, and no electrolytics on this whole motherboard. No electrolytics. No sign of electrolytics. They are all polymer capacitors. So yeah, my only complaint about this board is maybe the Ethernet controller, which is gigabit. It is gigabit, but it is an Atheros controller. It's this little chip right down there. It is an Atheros chipset, which I'm not really fond of. I would have preferred an Intel chipset, of course. Intel NICs are like the best NICs. Intel and now dead 3COM. 3COM used to be like the best of the best. But yeah. And Broadcom. Broadcom NICs are also pretty good. And well, I could throw in one in a PCIe slot, but I would be actually bottlenecked by the PCIe slot. So that wouldn't be cool at all. This is actually PCI Express, so no bottleneck right there. So yeah. Oh, it's also got three USB 2.0 front panel headers, one FireWire header, audio. Well, it is motherboard. It is it is actually an enthusiast grade, quote unquote, motherboard. So yeah. At least I will be able to overclock the Xeon that I put in here. I will be limited to half the cores and half the cache and half the processing power, but I will be able to at least compensate a little bit by overclocking. So yeah. That's about that for this part. Just look at this mess. Look at this mess. Holy crap. I have a freaking 5870 right there. Just, and I have like, I mean, if this were 2007, or no, actually 2009, I'd have like, I'd have, well, these two would be like $1,000, and those two would be $2,000. So I'd have like $3,000 worth of Xeons on this table, and this motherboard probably would be worth about another 1,000, and this ECC memory would be probably about, what, 200 or so. Oh, and the GPU would be 200 too. So, yeah, I would have quite a bit of money in here. Now it's all worth crap. Now this is all worth crap. Except, it ironically, probably the thing that has held its value the best is this friggin' keyboard. Because of this friggin' logo right there. That's the only reason why this keyboard is still valuable today. Because of that friggin' logo right there, that Apple logo. These things, these Apple Pro keyboard thingy majiggers, even though they are USB 1.1, they have USB 1.1 hubs on them. They're not mechanical, they are rubber dome. They're nice rubber domes, but they're not the nicest. An IBM rubber dome just beats the crap out of one of these. Even then, these things... And I run out of space again. So I was saying, these things still go for like 30 or 20 bucks on eBay. That is, depending on your local currency. If you're in the UK, it will cost you 20 pounds. If you're in Europe, it will cost you 20 euro. If you're in the United States, it will cost you $20. One of these. Yeah. Apple products do hold their value. Literally a freaking rubber dome keyboard. By the way, I bought this one at a thrift store for 1 euro. Because it is a keyboard. It is just a freaking keyboard. That's it. Well, it has a hub. It has a USB hub, so that's something a little bit amusing. So, while the previous cut, the previous part of this video was transferring to my server, I went ahead and I installed the P5Q inside the case. Right there, I put all the standoffs in their places and I installed the board, and it's looking quite good, actually. It's looking quite good. The 8-pin is gonna be a pain in the arse, because, yeah, it connects right up there, but it freaking blocks the airflow for that heatsink right there. And the 24-pin, don't even get me started. Why the heck? I have an Asus P5NE SLI, which is like 2 years older than this board, and they did it right. They put the 24-pin right here where it should be, right here. Why the heck did they put the freaking 24-pin on this motherboard here? Why? Just why? I mean, tell me how the frick I am supposed to route the cable. Tell me how the frick I am supposed to route this thick ass bunch of cables up to there from the power supply. Well, down there actually, from the power supply, without restricting airflow. Yeah, freaking tell me. Because I don't freaking know. I mean, I plug it in. I freaking plug it in, and what? I pass them through here? On top of the graphics card? On top of the freaking graphics card. And then through here. I don't know. But yeah. This chipset is gonna need some cooling, because I'm gonna overclock the shit out of it when the Xeon is in there. I'm gonna overclock the shit out of it. And I am telling you, I am gonna get, if I don't get at least 3.4 gigahertz out of one of these two solar Xeons, if I don't get at least 3.4 gigs out of one of these, I'm gonna be really disappointed. Really disappointed. Of course, I'm gonna be buying 800 megahertz sticks of RAM for that. So yeah, I hope I can get at least 3.4 out of one of these. Well, these one, using one of these heat sinks, by the way, and these are 92 millimeter fan heat sinks, Knox Hummers. They're, well, they're decent. They're not a Hyper 212 Evo, because that wouldn't fit in this case. I mean, this case is slim. It is really slim. As you can see, the power supply barely fits. It even sticks out of this side a little bit. And the side cover right here has a little bit of a recession in it, as you can see, just so we can, so the power supply can fit. This thing is really, really skinny. So, yeah. But yeah, enough rambling. Dual Xeons, discarded, completely discarded. I mean, completely discarded. I mean, no Dual Xeons. Forget about that. No Dual Xeons. So now, single Xeon. I'll be limited to 8 gigs of RAM, because there's no such thing as 4 gig sticks of DDR2 non-registered memory. So 8 gigs of RAM, single Xeon. What you gonna do? Life is cruel. But hey, I will be able to play video games, at least. Quad core is still good enough to play video games, right? Right? Well, you know, comment, like, subscribe, whatever, and bye.